You are listening to the life of Jesus Christ in a year from the visions of Anne Catherine Emmerich from TAN. I'm Father Edward Looney, and each day I will be reading and offering commentary to guide you through Anne Catherine Emmerich's magnificent mystical revelations. In addition to listening, you can follow along with the four-volume hardcover set of the life of Jesus Christ and biblical revelations available from TAN. Before we get to today's reading, though, let us ask the intercession of our venerable author. O blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich, devout and pious follower of Christ, who patiently endured the frailty of this mortal condition, who humbly received the honorable marks of Christ Jesus on your hands, feet, side, head, and chest, the marks which you were blessed by the Lord to witness for yourself in his own sufferings, we graciously ask for your intercession with God, that we sinners may be forgiven of our sins and be drawn more completely into spiritual communion with Christ, our Lord and our Savior. We ask this in the name of the most holy Lamb of God, and through the intercession of Holy Mary, our Mother. Amen. Today is day number 59. In this episode, we'll continue reading from Volume 1. We'll be continuing with the section related to the public ministry of Jesus. Today, we will read Numbers 14 and 15. 14. Jesus in Nazareth. Next morning, Jesus resumed his instructions. Two of the Pharisees from Nazareth came to him and in a friendly manner invited him to go back with them to the school. They had, as they said, heard so much of his teaching in the country around that they were eager to hear him explain the prophets. Jesus went with them. They conducted him to the house of a Pharisee in which many others were assembled. The five disciples were with their master. The Pharisees listened very politely to Jesus while he spoke to them in beautiful parables. His teaching appeared to please them greatly, and they led him to the synagogue where a numerous audience awaited him. Jesus spoke of Moses and explained the prophecies concerning the Messiah. But whenever he dropped any words from which they might infer that he alluded to himself, they showed displeasure. One of the Pharisees spread for him a repast, and he spent the night with his five disciples at an inn near the school. Next day, Jesus addressed a crowd of publicans who were journeying just then to receive the baptism. He afterward taught them in the synagogue, making use of a similitude of the grain of wheat, which must die in the earth before producing its fruit. His words displeased the Pharisees, and they repeated their remarks about the son of the carpenter Joseph. They reproached him also for his communications with publicans and sinners, for which Jesus replied with great firmness. Then they took up the Essenes, whom they denominated hypocrites, who lived not according to the law. But Jesus showed them clearly that the Essenes were stricter followers of the law than the Pharisees. And so the reproach of hypocrisy fell back upon themselves. It was the question of benedictions that had led to the Essenes. Blessings were in common use among them, and the Pharisees were annoyed at seeing Jesus blessing little children. When, for instance, he was entering or leaving the synagogue, he was stopped by many mothers with their children, and his blessing craved for the little ones. While Jesus dwelt at Nazareth, he had always much to do with the children, who became still and quiet near him. No matter how passionately they cried, his blessing had power to calm them. The mothers, remembering this, now brought their little ones to him to see whether he had become too proud to notice them. There were some among them who kicked violently, rolling over and over on the floor, as if they had cramps, screaming loudly all the while. But Jesus's blessing stilled them instantly. I saw something like a dark vapor going out from some of them. Jesus laid his hand on the heads of the boys and gave them the patriarch's blessing in three lines, one from the head and one from either shoulder down to the heart, where all three united. He blessed the girls in the same way, but without laying his hand on them, though he made a sign on their lips. I thought, as I saw him do it, that it meant that they should not prattle so much. Still, however, it was significant of something else. Jesus passed the night with his disciples in the house of a Pharisee. 15. Jesus rejects three rich youths. He confounds many learned men in the synagogue of Nazareth. To the five followers of Jesus, four others were now added, relatives and friends of the Holy Family. I think there was a son of one of the three widows among them, and one from Bethlehem, who had found out that he was a descendant of Ruth, who had married Booz in that city. Jesus formally received them to the number of his disciples. There were in Nazareth a couple of rich families who had three sons. In childhood, these latter had associated with Jesus. They were now quite cultured and well-educated. The parents, who had heard much of Jesus' wisdom and teaching, agreed together that their son should today hear a specimen of it. They would then offer him money to let the young men travel with him, that they might profit by his knowledge. The good people had so high an opinion of their sons that they thought Jesus would gladly become their tutor. So the young men went to the synagogue with her by the connivance of their wealthy parents and the Pharisees. All the learned men of the city had flocked. They were determined to put Jesus to the test in every way. Among these were a lawyer and a physician, the latter a tall, portly man with a long beard. He wore a girdle and had some kind of badge upon one shoulder of his mantle. I saw Jesus on entering the school again, blessing many children when their mothers brought to him, among them some afflicted with leprosy, whom he healed. During his discourse, he was interrupted in various ways by the literati, who proposed to him all kinds of subtle questions, but his wisdom silenced them. To the lawyer's speech, Jesus answered most wonderfully from the law of Moses, and when divorce was spoken of, he rejected it entirely. Divorced husband and wife could never be, but if the former could not in any way live with the latter, he might leave her. Still were they one body and could not again marry. These words of the Lord greatly displeased the Jews. The physician asked whether he could tell whether a man was of a dry, matter-of-fact nature or of a phlegmatic disposition, under what planets such a one was born, what simples were good for this or that temperament, and how the human body is formed. Jesus answered him with great wisdom. He spoke of the complexion of some of those present, their diseases, and the remedies, and of the human body, with a depth of knowledge quite unknown to the physician. He spoke of life, of the spirit, and how it influences the body of sicknesses that could be cured only by prayer and amendment of such as needed medicine for their cure, and that in language so profound and yet so beautiful, that the physician in astonishment declared himself vanquished, and that he had never before heard such things. I think he afterward became one of Jesus' disciples. Jesus described to him the human body, with all its members, muscles, veins, nerves, and intestines, their special functions, and their various relations one with another, in general terms and yet with such accuracy that his questioner was humbled and silenced. There was an astrologer present who spoke of the course of the stars. He explained how one constellation ruled another, how different stars possessed different influences, and he discoursed upon comets and the signs of the zodiac. Jesus, in most appropriate language, treated with another upon architecture, the others of trade and commerce, with foreign nations taking occasion at the same time to censure severely the various fashions and frivolities lately introduced from Athens. He condemned likewise the games and juggling now in use among them, and which were also spreading throughout Nazareth and other places. These games were likewise a product of their intercourse with Athens. Jesus stigmatized them as unpardonable, since they that indulge in them look upon them as no sin. Consequently, they do no penance for them, and therefore they cannot be pardoned. His hearers were ravished at his wisdom. They begged him to take up his residence among them, offering to give him a house and all that he needed, questioning him also as to why he and his mother had removed to Capernaum. Jesus replied that he could not remain with them, and he spoke of his mission and the duties it imposed. In answer to their question as to why he had gone from among them, he said that it was because of his desire to dwell in a more central locality, etc. But they did not understand his reasons, and they were offended at his rejection of their offer, which they thought a very fine one. They looked upon his words, mission and duties, as the offspring of pride, and so they left the school that evening. The three youths, who were about the age of 20, greatly desired to speak with Jesus, but he would not allow them to do so until his 9 disciples were present. That annoyed them. Jesus told them that he insisted upon having witnesses to what he might say to them. When at last they were admitted to an audience, they very modestly and humbly laid before him their own and their parents' wishes, that he would receive them as his pupils. Their parents, they said, would remunerate him, and as for themselves, they would bear him company in all his labors. They would serve and help him. I saw that Jesus was troubled at having to refuse their request, partly for their own sake and partly on account of his disciples, for he was obliged to assign reasons for his refusal, which they could not as yet comprehend. He replied to the youths that he had gave money to obtain something aimed at gaming, some temporal advantage, but that whoever would follow him must abandon all earthly possessions, must leave parents and friends, and that his disciples must neither woo nor marry. He laid down many other conditions, so that the young men became very much discouraged. They argued that many of the Essenians were married. Jesus replied that they, the Essenians, acted rightly and in accordance with their laws, but that his doctrine was to accomplish fully that for which theirs only paved the way, etc. With this remark and bidding them take time to reflect, he left them. The disciples were intimidated by his words. His teaching was so severe that they could not understand it, and they grew faint-hearted. But on the way from Nazareth to Eliud's, he bade them not despond, that he had good reasons for talking as he had done, that those youths would only at some distant day, and perhaps never, come to him, but as for themselves, the disciples, they should follow him calmly, and be without anxiety, etc. And so they arrived at Eliud's. I do not think he will again go to Eliud's, for great talk and excitement had arisen in Nazareth on his account. The inhabitants were vexed at his not remaining among them. They thought that he had acquired all his knowledge during his travels. True, they said, he is a very clever and extraordinary man, but for a carpenter's son, he is rather conceited. I saw the three young men returning to their homes. Their parents were very much displeased at the objections Jesus made to receiving them. The sons chimed in with the parents, and all talked at random in their indignation against him. On the following day, the three youths went again to Jesus and begged once more to be accepted. They promised him perfect obedience and faithful service. But Jesus again dismissed them, and I saw that their inability to seize the meaning of his refusal troubled him. He spoke then with his 9 disciples, who, by his directions, were to go first to a certain place and afterward to John. On the subject of those whom he had dismissed, Jesus said that they desired to follow him for the sake of what they might gain, that they were not willing to give all for love, but that they, the disciples, sought for nothing. Consequently, they had been received. He spoke again in significant and beautiful terms of the baptism, telling them to go over to Capernaum to say to his mother that he was going to the baptism. He charged them likewise to speak to the disciples, John, Peter, and Andrew, about John the Baptist, and say to the last named that he, Jesus, was coming. This concludes our reading for today, and now we reflect over what we have just listened to, what we have just read. We have Jesus in Nazareth. Of course, we know this is where Mary first received the Annunciation, that they returned to Nazareth, that Nazareth was the home of Jesus for many, many years. We also know that Jesus made his residence in Capernaum during his public ministry, and we've heard several references to Capernaum in our reading today and in the last several days and weeks, of course, as well. A lot of the things that Jesus is doing, he will continue to do. He was teaching in the synagogue. He used the parable of the grain of wheat, which must die in the earth before it produces fruit. So that's something, a teaching. And you wonder if Jesus is developing his teaching. He tells this parable, and then he'll continue to expand upon it as he comes to a greater understanding of it. I think for a lot of us, we share some of the same stories over and over again because that's what we know, and it communicates a teaching or a truth. It shares something. Jesus also welcomes the children. What should come to mind is one of the passages of the Gospels, you know, let the little children come to me. Do not prevent them. People were annoyed. The Pharisees were annoyed at seeing Jesus blessing the children. And Jesus had the ability to calm a child. I know that you've probably have had that experience. Maybe it was at Mass, maybe it's at a restaurant, but a child just in this great fit, nothing can calm the child, nothing the mother or father does. But imagine that happening, and then Jesus comes, and that child experiences great peace from Jesus. Anne Catherine Emmerich interestingly says that, I saw something like a dark vapor going out from some of them. This was when Jesus was blessing. So that dark vapor seems, this is not the first time she uses such description. So it has to be kind of the symbolism of evil leaving someone, that in the presence of Christ, this dark vapor is the evil leaving and goodness from Christ filling them. And then Jesus rejects three rich youths and confounds the learned in the synagogue of Nazareth. One of the things, that really struck me was how people were already trying to put Jesus to the test. They were determined to put Jesus to the test in every way, and Jesus is able to respond and take them on, accept their challenge. And another realization too, I didn't necessarily realize how significant of a problem leprosy was. Boy, Jesus heals lepers in the Gospels, we know that. But in this book already, he's healed lepers and the lepers are around him and everything. And so there's something, just kind of the awareness of, well, that was a very prevalent disease. It's not, you know, one in every 10,000 people, but probably a lot more statistically had leprosy. And, you know, Jesus comes to heal them and to make them clean. The words of Jesus greatly displeased the Jews, and those words specifically were about divorce. Divorced husband and wife could never be, but if the former could not in any way live with the latter, he might leave her. Still were they one body and could not again marry. Well, isn't this, you know, the teaching of Jesus we know from the gospel reiterated here? But this is one of the great teachings that confounds modern man, you know, to use that language describing this section. to be confounded. People are confounded over the church's stance on divorce and the need for an annulment and things like that. Difficult teaching. It was difficult at the time of Jesus, still difficult today, still demanding of people who might find themselves in that situation. Jesus was also engaging in conversation about the zodiac, so about the stars and constellations. Just think that's an interesting conversation for the Lord. Of course, Jesus is the part of the Trinity. He is the second person of the Trinity. Jesus, as Son, was there at the creation of the world, so he knows these things because he is the Creator God. So he's able to respond and interact with the people questioning because he has this knowledge, because he's God, he's omniscient, he's all-knowing. You know, that's something that we heard, you know, he acquired all his knowledge during his travels, people were saying. Well, no, Jesus acquires it because he's God. He knows all. Just kind of let that ring in. Jesus is omniscient. He's all-knowing. We're getting closer to the baptism. Jesus sending for his mother and others. That's a curious thing, you know, sending for his mother and these other disciples. Is Mary going to be there at the baptism? Does she undergo it too? These are just questions I anticipate as, you know, Anne Catherine Emmerich is preparing us for that scene. So we will continue to wait, and we will soon hear the story of the baptism, this great buildup for the beginning of Christ's public ministry. This brings us to an end of our reading and reflection for today. Please be sure to subscribe to the podcast and sign up for email notifications at emmerichpodcast.com and use coupon code ACE25 for 25% off your next order at tanbooks.com. Also, please share the podcast with others. Email it to your friends, text a link, invite them to begin listening so that you can have holy conversations with your family and friends about the writings of Anne Catherine Emmerich. Don't forget to rate and review the podcast on whatever platform you're listening. I hope you'll join us next time as we continue meditating on the life of Jesus Christ and biblical revelation with the help of Blessed Anne Catherine Emmerich. Until then, may God bless you, and Mary pray for you.